I have a confession to make. I love watching alien conspiracy shows. Well, I used to, that is. I think it's because so much of my work deals with the rawness of human relationships that I would find myself looking for something so outside of reality that I could just turn my brain off and be entertained by the otherworldliness of it all. Now, before you skip this episode, hear me out. No, we aren't going to talk about aliens or even conspiracies. I know some of you are disappointed. But I realized that there was another element to this side obsession of mine that intersects with our military culture. Regardless of whether I believed any of it, I think what I loved most was seeing people share their stories. Stories that had become so true to them that it eclipsed their fear of other people's opinion of them. From my perspective, they were either far more brave than I or simply mad. But then in July of 2023, this obsession got a little too close to home. No, I didn't see a UFO. But I eagerly watched four service members testify in front of Congress about their sightings and knowledge of a government UAP program. As I listened to these men all sharing an oath to their country and to honorable service, I cringed as one man shared the moral injury of threats and reprisal by the institution he had committed to serve. His medical record, which included a PTSD diagnosis, was leaked to the public to discredit him, as well as other far more concerning threats.
I had some unique things happen in my personal life that, you know, were some of the causal factors for me to file a complaint, some things that my wife and I had noticed, some intimidation. I can't get into the exact nature. I did provide that information to the inspector general, and hopefully they've referred it to appropriate federal law enforcement and counterintelligence personnel. But I can't discuss that publicly because of the sensitive nature of that for my own protection and for the integrity of the investigation. That's one of the reasons why I went public. And certainly I was shown that, you know, they can touch me at any time. And that's what led me to not only contact my former agency's, you know, counterintelligence folks with, you know, what I witnessed, and I provided evidence to that fact, but filed the complaint. And certainly going public was the appropriate move for me for my own protection. So, you know, for a lot of reasons.
This story unfortunately ended my lighthearted quest for truth about UFOs and instead merged it with an everyday, very real understanding of what it's like in our culture to speak truth to power. While UAPs and confidential government programs are an extreme controversial example, there are far more down-to-earth and realistic examples of service members courageously speaking their truth in a quest for personal healing and hope for initiating institutional change. Most of them sacrifice their career to do so. Can an institution as large as our Department of Defense change? What is it about our relationship with the DoD that makes it difficult to ask for healthy accountability and transparency? I sat down with Ryan Sweazy, director of Walk the Talk Foundation, a nonprofit that protects military whistleblowers, to help us understand the power dynamics many feel every day. I'm Corie Weathers. You're listening to Military Culture Shift, a limited series podcast on the impact of war, money, and generational perspective on morale, retention, and leadership. Ryan, welcome. Thank you for joining the conversation with me.
Thanks, Corie. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, I know that you're a former pilot. Are you still a pilot? Tell us a little bit about your background when it comes to the armed services.
Yeah, so a 22-year veteran of the Air Force, retired in February of 2022. For most of that service, I was a fighter pilot flying F-16s, both in the operational as well as the test world. And then for about the last 5 years or so of my career, I pivoted to the military diplomatic arena, where I was air attaché to Italy and Switzerland. I did that as my penultimate assignment, and then retired out of the air staff in the spring of 2022. And since then, I've been flying commercially for a major airline.
And I imagine you're Gen X. I'm a Gen X. Yep. So what brought you in the first place?
Yeah, you know, that's a great question. None of my family had strong military ties. Really, the draw was to fly. And at the time, growing up and approaching college age in the early 90s, one of the few avenues to get to the commercial aviation world was actually through the military. I think in my heart of hearts, the ultimate goal was to fly for the airlines, and the military was a cool means to an end in that regard.
You're an entirely different realm of things as far as working around the institution with the Walk the Talk Foundation. So can we start there and just we share a little bit about the foundation, what you do, and maybe where did that come from?
Yeah, so the foundation, which is Walk the Talk, which is really the title is kind of a pointed message to the government in that I don't feel that they do walk the talk when it comes to a lot of the rhetoric about protections for victims and complainants within the military. And I'm sure we'll get to that in a little bit. But the aim is essentially eradicating retaliation, reprisal, and restriction within the military. And we do that via two ways. We have an individual centric side of the house of the operation where I and my team of advisors just walk people through a myriad of different administrative processes, whether that be inspector general, whether it be equal opportunity, whether it be command-directed investigation, anything that's non-criminal in nature, really administrative in nature. We walk them through that. And the service that provides the niche that it fills is that as a complainant or a subject in the military, you're not afforded any advisement or any counsel, which is unlike the criminal process. And you really need it because the process itself is very confounding. It's administratively heavy. It can be laden with pitfalls and setbacks. And if you're the average layman service member, you really don't know what to do and how to conduct or basically how to represent yourself pro se in essence. And so that's the service we provide from an individual centric standpoint. And then the second side is the advocacy piece, engaging with other advocate groups and or the Congress in trying to pursue substantive systemic changes for the military to include a revamping of the inspector general system and other avenues of recourse and redress.
So this is a huge topic, Ryan. Was there something in particular? Is there a story you can share that really ignited this fire for you? Because I mean, you really are storming the castle in this advocacy, really trying to change the system. And I know over the course of writing Military Culture Shift, I had several people that are like, are you trying to change the institution? Because you know that's not going to work, you know, and it's such a discouraging message. And yet when there is room for systemic change, or when you see that there are certain patterns and systems that need to change and can change, it can be really discouraging to want to bring about that change and have people tell you, you can't, it's not worth it, it's too big, whatever. So what ignited this for you? Because this is a big thing. It's a big thing to take on in addition to the job that you already have.
Yeah, it's a massive undertaking, and you're going against the juggernaut of the Department of Defense that essentially doesn't want to change. So you're absolutely right in that it is a long slog. But there were two events in my career that really ignited that fire. The first was when I was an inspector general myself in the Air Force in my last operational tour from about 2013 to 2016, I saw a peek behind the curtain as to how dysfunctional the system was and how really a complainant and witness and usually victim and complainant usually being one and the same in most investigations really had the deck stacked against them. They had very little resources. Mm-hmm. They had no representation, and they had to essentially plead their case to the government, that being the United States military, that wasn't very apt to admitting culpability. So that was kind of my introduction into the shortcomings of the system. And then in my penultimate assignment, when I was with the Defense Intelligence Agency as a military diplomat, I actually was a victim of reprisal myself after having reported to my colleagues for dereliction of duty and toxic workplace. And the agency retaliated by canceling my assignment and writing a subpar performance report. But the journey that that started me on was navigating this Inspector General system, this avenue of redress, and just experiencing firsthand as a victim how wrought with corruption and dysfunction it was. And as I was doing that, I was talking to more and more people who were seeing more and more of the same thing. And I said, there needs to be an entity of some sort to help these people out, because that doesn't exist. And that was the genesis of my foundation.
I think it's not only incredibly brave, it's just inspiring to see you want to do the right thing for people. And I think regardless of what job we have, we're interacting with people, we're serving people on a daily basis. And I really think it shows just the value that you're putting on people who need that help and need that assistance, and going out of your way to do that. And so I would love to kind of get into what you have seen, and maybe we can kind of flesh this out together. So maybe it's a little bit of a devil's advocate. We could kind of start from there and kind of pull it apart. But, I think most people would say, all right, the institution is this machine. It's built to be a lethal fighting force, to be our nation's security, all of those kinds of things that you hear all the time. But it's also an institution that is made up of people that are trying to do their jobs, people that are doing the, and I want to say, because I'm on the clinician side, I often want to say people are doing oftentimes the best they can. Most people are trying to do the right thing. But something starts to like fall apart when we have these patterns within a system where things are not changing or they're not being run well. So what would you say is happening? Like, why do you feel like there is such obstacles in the way of this going right? What's going wrong with people? I have a couple of ideas in my head, but what have you seen?
Oh boy, if there's one thing that's kept me up at night with my work at the foundation over the past 2 years, it goes to this question exactly, which is why? Why would a military institution be so hell-bent on fighting, discrediting, discounting complainants when the majority of complainants are in the right? In fact, they've been told it's their duty to report wrongdoing to the chain of command. Why would that same chain or that same institution retaliate, and with such fervor? And to boot, conduct themselves in a manner which is oftentimes quite immoral and unethical in that retaliation. And so I always have gone back to the why. And I would surmise, so we're at about around about 180 cases now completed. And I believe that when a complainant raises an issue, they are then looked at in a culture which rewards uniformity and conformity. They're looked as a boat rocker, a troublemaker, a nonconformist, and or questioning the sanctity of that command. And I think from a psychological standpoint, those are the roots of why that retaliation comes so swiftly and really so bluntly many times, is that because the group, the institution, sees them as the bad apple, and that needs to be weeded out so that they can continue to cull the herd to assure that uniformity.
You know, you and I had a conversation prior to recording this, where we kind of fleshed out a little bit of this beforehand. And I was sharing with you the story of working with individuals in counseling and coaching sessions that may not have necessarily been victims when you talk about like victims of an actual wrongdoing that they've brought to hold the institution accountable. It could just be just feeling wronged by the institution, whether it is being moved too many times or not being heard or not being like, hey, like I need a timeout for my family, or just, you know, doing the best that they can and working really hard and being encouraged to have solid work ethic to the point of maybe even sacrificing themselves or their family only to get a poor performance review, or just like all of these things where they're dealing with what is happening in my relationship with an institution where I'm being asked to give loyalty and give all of my energy and give everything. And then when I ask for something, there is such a pushback. And so the best words that I've been able to come up with is this trauma bond that, you know, on the counseling side, we see it in unhealthy, toxic, even abusive relationships. But the idea behind this trauma bond is if somebody is dragging you through the desert, like literally dragging you through the desert, and you are starving and you need water and you are hurting, and then that same person dragging you through the desert gives you a glass of water, that same person that is causing you harm becomes your savior too. So I know that's a bunch of stuff to throw out there, but like, what are your thoughts?
Yeah, I think there are elements of abusive relationship, right? It's like, you're nothing without me. You need me. You can be replaced. If you speak out of turn, I will abuse you. I think there's a lot of validity to that, because there's just the same elements that you see, I'm sure, in abusive relationships as you do with the military, with the institution vis-a-vis victims. And that's why they become victims again in the system. And then married that with dare I say a little Stockholm syndrome as well. You start to develop affinity for your abuser slash captor. Some of the clients that I've dealt with, they were very averse to speaking out against the system, much to my befuddlement. And I think I can attribute that to some of the Stockholm syndrome, is that, you know, the army has loved me for so long. Yeah, but they're running you out at 19 years and you're not going to be pensionable, but yet you still refuse to go on record. Why is that? And I think it's a mixture of those two things, both the abusive relationship as well as Stockholm.
Yeah, it's frustrating and sad for me. It's interesting. I've been paying attention to my own reaction, even in my body, to putting out a book that is kind, but also telling the truth. And even in the last week, I have so much anxiety, as if I'm doing something wrong, as if I'm saying something wrong, as if I'm waiting for punishment. And yet it's such a positive message. I have to keep reminding myself, I'm like, I need to go back and reread the book and make sure I've not said something wrong. And yet, why should I not be able to, as a civilian and a spouse, say things that are true? And it just frustrates me that there are so many people that struggle with on much more simplified levels of being able to ask for change, ask for accountability, that there's so much fear and anxiety there.
And that, what you described really is a testament to how sadly, how effective this system is, right? And I say system in a very crass way. When someone is retributed against or is a victim of reprisal, it's a very visible and public thing, right? And their friends and their colleagues see it, and sometimes it purports out to become urban legend, but it's very effective in a psychological standpoint, in that it becomes an enormous deterrent for the next would-be complainant or the next would-be whistleblower, right? And you, as a active duty dependent, correct? The fact that you feel it is an enormous testament to how pervasive this system of retribution has really propagated, right? And you know, when I was authoring a report to Congress about a year ago, and that was coming out of the Defense Intelligence Agency, there were about 200 people who contacted me and said, I'm seeing this wrongdoing. I was a victim of that. And in the end, only about 65 of those 200 plus put anything in writing. And of those, only about a quarter put their name to it. Mm. I think that's a very telling statistic in the how palpable this culture of retribution in the military is.
Well, let me react to that, maybe as I think listeners might react to that, because I think listeners might come from, let me just start with two extremes. Like, on one hand, somebody might be listening and going, it's a conspiracy that government is out to like hurt everybody, right? And there's, you know, all this really unhealthy, extreme controversy and conspiracy happening. And then the other extreme is everybody's doing the best they can and people are misunderstanding and making a bunch of assumptions. And this is really not an issue. It's really more of like a real legitimate issue. It's really just everybody's reaction to it. And I tend to think when I can find those extremes, the truth is somewhere in the middle. But you're dealing with some of these very extreme cases all the time. So where would you say on the spectrum things actually are? Like, do you feel that people, I guess it depends on what the topic is and what is being exposed, but is it more so that leadership are rolling with just what they've always known? And so they just know to not rock the boat themselves and experiencing that same fear and it snowballs? Or would you say there's really, not regulation, but there's rules in place or patterns in place that we just don't rock the system? Because last thing, my brain immediately goes to, you know, oftentimes we're not supposed to rock the system because they can always say our adversaries are watching, our allies are watching. So what is message is that putting out about our strength and readiness as a force if there's cracks in the system? So we just don't say anything at all. So there's kind of like these little hedges that I feel like come around that controls the message. So what do you feel like is happening on the spectrum if you were to give an answer?
Ooh, lots of cover here. Yeah, I'd say from the spectrum of conspiracy theory to everyone acting a good intent, I'd agree with you that it's somewhere in the middle as well. I think there's not an active collusion to work against the individual member, but there is a kind of de facto symbiosis among these actors to all toe the same line and to work against the individual complainant as well. And there's an element of groupthink. There's a strong element of groupthink, I believe, in this, especially as you go into the senior ranks of the officer corps. People who were rewarded by towing the line, by singing the company line in order to get to that point, and then are rewarded further by, again, running with the pack. And to go against the grain or to speak out of turn is, for them, career suicide. So there's a lot of external influences working on the individual who, as a rational human, just is doing what is incentivized and rewarded. And unfortunately, the groupthink is to out those boat rockers, those outliers, what have you, and to get a cohesive, conformist group moving in the same direction as we envision any kind of military unit to be. And because that's rewarded or incentivized, then the leadership of the institution does that, just as any rational human being would. I had a recent case that we're dealing with, and that one of the soldiers who was a client of ours was going through some significant mental health challenges. And instead of getting that person help, his immediate supervisor was being pressured into marking him as deployable, which he clearly was not. Well, why is that? It's because his commander and her commander and his commander all incentivized and rewarded to green up, quote unquote, the unit, or to call it 100% combat effective, or what have you. And that reward and incentive is higher than taking care of your people. Mm-hmm. Right. And so moving that and kind of using the parallel for any kind of whistleblower or complainant or victim, it's the same phenomenon throughout the board. You are rewarded by having this unified group where you have outcast the outliers, where you have eliminated the counterculturists and the boat rockers, and you're now 100% mission effective because that is what the military rewards.
Yeah, I think you're right too. And when we talk about bullet points, when we talk about those OERs and performance reviews, everybody needs to be able to show that they made progress moving forward, not backwards, not necessarily being bogged down with problems, but being able to show, did you somehow positively impact the organization moving it forward towards readiness, I think, instead of towards health that leads to readiness.
Right. Yeah.
So, okay. This is where I think it gets super interesting, because I would say that boomers and Gen X, obviously Gen X a little bit less than boomers, but have been brought up to keep their head down, have incredibly strong work ethic and value work. And for boomers, I would say success even over family at times. And so what I saw is Gen X coming into the force, and they really wanted a healthy work family life balance, but it was afraid to ask for it because they were also kind of inherited the keep your head down and just get to work and do your job. And you are promoted or you are given accolades for doing that. It was kind of like you hear all the time people saying no news is good news, right? Like I don't need to hear from you unless I actually need to change the direction or do something different, where millennials started to come on the scene and they were already a louder generation, having been brought up before the internet, a little bit of before the internet. They were already a louder generation when it came to asking for public change, protesting, using their actual voices, and they were not necessarily afraid of asking for change. And then if you've got Gen Z coming in, who doesn't necessarily need to be as loud as millennials because they've figured out how to use the internet to do a lot of that work for them. So what I think is happening right now, and I'd love to hear your reaction to it, I think what's happening is the Gen X and Boomer is on the upper levels of senior leadership, and they're still, they've been imprinted on, I think, with the old military and what it's always been, and a lot of the constructs that you're talking about, where it's like, this is, we just don't rock the boat. That's just, we don't know why you don't rock the boat. You just don't rock the boat. And then you've got this cohort that's coming in that millennials, their motive, their question is why. They have no problem asking why. And it's disrupting the whole system to have two generations coming in that are really not willing to be quiet or don't have problems with rocking the boat. And I think that's a little bit of the clash that's happening. So I see you nodding your head. Any thoughts on that?
I do. I have two thoughts. It goes to number one, power, and then it goes to a generation gap. There's two major factors I want to talk to here, because in my work, one of the things I've become interested in is this recruiting and retention issue within the military. And it all centers around Gen Z and in the military trying to get its arms around its generational gap. I think after reading some insights from some senior leaders, they unfortunately fall into this trap of, this is how it was for us. It needs to be that way for Gen Z. And that's just not working. Mm-hmm. Our society has changed, and it's the military that needs to change its culture in order to attract and retain, not vice versa. That's what they don't mm-hmm. seem to understand. And you see with these cases that involve Gen Zers is that very much that same mindset is that they're vocal, they're questioning why, they're calling whatever into question. And in our generation, the Gen Xers in positions of authority, we don't like that.
Yeah.
And that segues to the second factor, which is power. Mm-hmm. I think one of the factors that we haven't discussed yet, but it was a major player in all this, is individual sense of ego and power. Mm-hmm. And when a complainant alleges something, especially if it's against the chain of command, the chain of command takes that very much as an existential threat to their authority, mm-hmm. which is not the case. That's not the whole point of the process, but that's not how it's taken. And so this perception and reality with our generation, who are now the up and coming senior leaders of the military, it is the root problem of these two issues, whether it be the power or the misunderstanding of the generational gap, which is my authority's being challenged. How dare they? I will crush them in a very public way so that other would-be complainants can watch them. And it happens. Mm-hmm. And as a commander, unfortunately, you have a lot of authorities in the military not to do good. You have very few authorities to impact directly someone in a positive way. That's just how the Uniform Code of Military Justice is set up. However, you have a myriad of ways to ruin someone. And it's very easy, and there's very little checks and balances and very little oversight on that command authority, for right or for wrong. We can discuss that later. But for someone to challenge you as a commander, as a colonel, as a general, you have the ability to squash them. And oftentimes, that's exactly what happens. So along with the other factors that we talked to previously about the groupthink and the incentive reward system and this pack mentality very much plays the role of power, especially as it pertains to a person who's trying to retain it and may not be as legitimate either, and therefore retains it in not so scrupulous ways. But then going to the generational gap thing, it's like, yeah, I have read senior leaders' thoughts on the recruiting issue, and it very much comes across as, well, Gen Z just needs to conform to what we need. Yeah. No, actually, it's exactly the opposite.
Yeah. Oh yeah. It's almost entertaining at this point. I actually did a Facebook poll yesterday, so it's still live. By the time people are listening now, it may not be live, but I read one more article where, you know, the DoD had put out this messaging that recruitment issues and Gen Z is the problem, but our retention is great. And I was like, I don't buy that. I don't think it's true because in our brigade that we are serving in at Fort Cavazos right now, on a weekly basis, we hear from another millennial who is putting in their packet and leaving. And we have so many Gen X that are like, they're in that first retirement system, so they're just trying to get to 20. So I put out this poll and I was like, I don't buy it. How many of you are, you know, aiming for 20 and having a great time and saying this is like your time of your life and everything is great? How many of you are barely hanging on and you're just trying to cross the finish line, but would leave if you could? How many of you have plans to leave versus how many are just like doing their initial commitment and leaving? And so far, the majority of people are just barely hanging on and would leave if they could, but they're in that first retirement system. And there was second in line are those that have plans to leave. And so I really don't think that we are, that our retention is what everybody is saying it is. And if it is, I think we're actually on the brink of the next shift, which is going to be not just recruitment issues, but people leaving in swarms, because it is going back to your group think. You know, when I was writing the book, I kept thinking about, this is not a culture of people that will protest or be loud when something is wrong. They won't be vocal to all the reasons that you described in the beginning. So what does a cohort of people do if they can't use their voice? They'll quietly leave or they'll quietly quit. And that's what I saw after Afghanistan. People, I mean, the whole country, if not the whole globe, was quiet quitting, like not sure if they wanted to go back to work. But there was something different happening, and I think, in the military culture, where people weren't so sure that they had the same loyalty that they had before. They just had a lot of questions, a lot of hurt, a lot of things to figure out. And so I think that I definitely agree. Gen Z is asking for things to be different, and the DoD is going to have to respond to that. I'd love for us to talk about this idea of authority, because I think that that is also something that has shifted with, and I have a whole chapter on authority and how that mindset has changed. And so I think that Gen Z especially is coming in and saying, you don't get authority with me just because of the rank that you have or the time that you've been working. You get authority from, I'll give you authority if I trust you and if you are someone that is worthy of my respect towards you. It's a relational, almost agreement. And something is clashing with this structure that we have in place versus this new understanding of authority and gift of authority is the way that I see it.
Boy, yeah, lots to unpack there, but violently nodding my head north and south to all your points for sure. Yeah, let's talk about first the Gen Z. They're not out in the streets. They're not protesting, but they're not showing up to the recruiting centers either, right?
Yeah.
And they're speaking with their feet. And one element I think that is worth mentioning here is the advent of social media and the propagation of what people see as the truth. I think for Gen Xers who came in, and many of them in the 9/11 era, we were fairly naive when it concerned rights and authorities and this question of who could do what to you. A lot of us joined at or around 2001, and we were eager to serve. And I think we were headstrong and foolhardy. And the military kind of took advantage of that, I think, a little bit. And this discussion that we're having now about rights and what you forfeit and what you don't and why, I didn't really see that as an up-and-coming officer at all. And now, especially in my work in the foundation, but also with the people now enlisting, it's definitely in the conversation, as it should be. And I'll talk to that in a second. But on the topic of authorities, and this is something that's really gotten my attention in the last 2 years, is this question about, okay, from one perspective, and we're going to devil's advocate this a little bit, I understand why commanders have these absolute authorities in times of war, deployment, battlefield, et cetera. They have to make decisive decisions, and there's no time and no place for debate. And that I get. I understand. I've seen it. However, when you're peacetime in garrison, that doesn't apply. Mm-hmm. However, in today's structure in the military, those commanders retain all those absolute authorities. I think that's completely wrong. I think there needs to be a division because, quite frankly, they've abused it and they forfeit that right. And I see it with every case. It is an abuse of authority defined. And now, with the pervasive social media, I think we see more and more of that, and we hear more and more of that, and it's becoming a discussion, which is absolutely the right thing. And I vehemently believe that Gen Z has seen the fruitless conflicts of the last 20 years. They've seen the abuses like sexual harassment, sexual assault go unchecked for two decades. They see how you really have very few rights as a service member. And they're saying, no, thank you. And they're not saying it loudly. And they're not rioting, but they're not showing up and they're not enlisting. And that is speaking volumes in and of itself.
I found your foundation because you actually gave a response to West Point's call for solutions, which I have found really comical that we were at a place where everybody's asking for solutions from anyone. So you actually had written an essay about what your solution would be. So you want to share a little bit about, like, what do you think needs to shift? You're obviously thinking on a systemic level. What are you saying is that needs to happen in the system?
Yeah. You know, the background to the answer is that, and again, I've watched, I've kind of spectated this whole recruiting issue because it ties into a lot of what I do. I think a lot of what I do at the foundation, unfortunately, just statistically speaking, many people end up not getting the justice they deserve, and they end up becoming very disenfranchised, and many of them leaving, and understandably so. And so in parallel, I watch the steady decline of not only recruiting and retention. I agree with you, there's a retention issue as well. I can say that for a fact, coming from the Air Force Fighter Pilot Corps. Not only is there that, but there is a steady decline that America's trust in American trust vis-a-vis the military institution, that is inextricably linked. Less and less the country trusts the military. And that's kind of troubling to me, because for many years, we enjoyed a high level of trust, a high level of esteem and prestige, and that is eroding quickly. And while that has occurred, I have seen the military institution and the leadership thereof blame it all on all these exogenous external issues that they could find, whether it be out of shape Gen Zers, whether it be the base realignment and closure, there's less bases, so there's less outreach, whether it be COVID, I mean, you name it, they've named it, except for themselves. Yeah. And I find that to be very telling, that they either don't want to come to terms or they're oblivious to the reality that a lot of the decay in the military is directly attributable to their poor leadership, to their mismanagement, and their dysfunction and corrupt systems of justice in the institution.
The great news is that there is plenty of lessons learned and examples out there of corporations and businesses who needed to rebuild trust with their constituents or their customers or the public. I mean, since cancel culture started, there has been plenty of examples of that transparency and authenticity and rebuilding a brand. And so, you know, I think about how many examples we already have of brands not only turning their reputation around, but rebuilding loyalty based off of that authenticity. And there's times where I just want to like scream at the DoD and just like, you, like, this is not brand new. This is something you can do, but it has to start with authenticity. And I wonder if going back to the fear mindset, I wonder if it has a lot to do with not wanting to show cracks in the system and trying to stay that position of power as a country and having, you know, a force that need, you know, that can handle whatever. And frankly, lately too much, I think.
Okay. By the way, this is a great conversation. I'm really enjoying this. I'm going to pose two questions and hopefully you answer the way I think you're going to answer. Okay. And it'll make my point. This could go sideways though. Okay. What would you argue is a very important step and maybe the first step in any, whether it be a relationship, whether it be a person, whether it be an organization, what's the first step in reconciliation?
Well, I'm going to say as a clinician, ownership.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
You know, I mean, okay. Saying I'm sorry usually is the first response and then taking ownership. But unfortunately, most relationships in conflict react with defensiveness.
Yeah. Now, okay, we'll save that answer. Now, can you name the last time a senior military leader has gotten up on a podium stage in the press and said, I'm sorry, I own that?
No, except for, and I tried to highlight this as an example, except for when they were forced to with the housing mold crisis. I think there was moments where when, maybe if I actually adjust that question of yours just a little bit, because I've thought about this question, right? Because I think there have been moments, but the difference is, and this is the classic argument that happens in marriage and relationships too, which is somebody says they're sorry and the other person says, I don't think you mean it because you're just doing it out of obligation, right? Yeah. And so I think that often there is apology, yep, but it's done after they've been held accountable and forced by Congress to make progress in something. And so there is not the authentic, we were wrong, prior to someone forcing them to say it.
Yes. And I agree with you 1,000% again. And the semi-rhetorical question is, why do we never see a senior military leader of their own volition, of their own accord, admit culpability, guilt, responsibility? And the only answer is that's what's rewarded. Right. Mm. So I think the military is at this critical impasse in which, yeah, the culture that has been bred, especially with our general officers and flag officers, is to never accept responsibility, to never admit guilt or culpability. But in order to really improve and progress of your own volition and own accord, you have to do that. So they are two mutually exclusive forces.
So if somebody's listening right now and they are a leader and they feel this, right? Like, how do we, if we can only change ourselves to start with, how do we encourage leaders to do something different. Like, let's say there is a leader that feels that and wants to own it and is scared to own it, right? It's just affecting their career, which leads to affecting the provision for my family, which leads to like all the other things. How do we begin with something different?
Yeah, I think the first thing, it reminds me of a former Mattis quote, former SecDef and four-star general, James Mattis. And he said a quote, I can't recite it verbatim, but essentially you need to be coddling and protecting the mavericks of your service who bring about questions that go counterculture, because you want that guy or gal to be posing the counterpoint and not your enemy, is what he said. And it's a great quote. Unfortunately, it doesn't happen in the military at all, because the counterculturists are weeded out. And that's because the service's values, and each service has them, and in the Air Force, it was integrity and excellence and service, I think. They don't mesh with what's really valued.
Yeah.
Right. So if you want to have the first step to a cultural change, which is a massive undertaking, you have to do something tangible that's going to reward people for doing what you want them to now do. Mm-hmm. So in the classic example and thing I work with a lot is the whistleblower. And the military says it is your duty to report wrongdoing, and then we will systemically crush you is what they then do, right? It is a total disconnect, because you can put values on a poster all day long, but people see what's really valued and what's really incentivized and rewarded. So if you want people to change, you have to give them that incentive to do that new thing. So for this, for saying, okay, we're going to allow ourselves the freedom to speak out, allow leaders to be able to accept culpability without retribution or without career demise, then you as an institution can reward that. It's just as simple as going down to the tactical level as an OER. If I were to have put in my final performance report, pursued congressional legislation to root out toxicity in the Defense Intelligence Agency as a whistleblower, they would have tossed it right out. Mm-hmm. But the absurdity is that I was told that was my responsibility and duty as an officer. But I couldn't put that in, and in no way would it be rewarded. And therein lies the first step. And that's rectifying that gap.
When you talk with the average service member, especially if they've been in for a while, who really have embraced, I think, the values and embrace the lifestyle, whatever that looks like, but really believe in what it is that they get to do. What I love about this tribe is that when they are in a tough situation, a majority of them are going to do the right thing. I love that about this group of people. When I was writing about Afghanistan's exit and just how chaotic that actually was, one of the things that I reflected on was, even in the chaos, even when everyone was frustrated, even though everybody had a lot of opinions about whether or not it was being done well or the right way, or if this is how it should have ended, at the end of the day, the service members that were there, that were executing whatever they were asked to execute, they did it with grace and humility and in service, and took care of the people in front of them. And it was remarkable to see people just do the right thing to take care of people as best as they could. And I just know we have the character to do it. It's just a matter of people being willing to just have the wisdom to know this actually builds more relationships than rips them apart. And I feel like that would, maybe I'm just being naive and overly positive, because you see people all the time who lose so much, but surely what's the positive that you're giving the people that are walking down this road and are bravely using their voices? Surely there is a silver lining or a character development that happens out of all of that that's worth it.
The reminiscent, I think it's Stu Scheller quote, is that every service member is willing to give their lives for their country, but very few their careers, right? Yeah. And why is that? Well, for a few reasons, some of them we've already talked to. The other is what's glorified, for lack of a better term, the person who dies in combat in line of duty is a hero. But the person who goes to the press and says, this was happening here and the chain of command and the inspector general all failed me, but I needed to see this through to make sure it was right. Well, what are they labeled? A whiner, you know, communist, what have you, right? It goes back again to the value system. But I think your question was like, is there hope, right? can this be rectified? Yes and no, mm-hmm. At least under the current construct. And it really comes down to, unfortunately, we are a simple animal, right? We'll do, you know, the bell rings and we salivate or you know, mm-hmm. we get the right answer. We get the banana out of the machine. And that's the first step. I think you would probably agree with, you know, the culture has to change, but that first incremental step, it can't be this monstrous leap. It can't be like, okay, our values have changed, go. Yeah. Right? You have to make it tangible. And oftentimes when I meet with whistleblower attorneys who are active in the financial sector, there's this thing called the Dodd-Frank Act, and it's for whistleblowers within the SEC realm. So they work in private companies or banks, and they've seen wrongdoing and they report it. And there's legislation that mandates that they get a cut of the sanctions if sanctions are levied, anywhere from 10 to 50%. And so that it not only incentivizes, and that's kind of puts it in a bad light, like you're mm-hmm. trying to get finks and rats and whatnot. What it does do is it insulates people from this scenario which you have in the military, which is 100% risk, 0% reward. Mm-hmm. It's a very risky thing to speak out against wrongdoing, especially when that wrong comes from the people who own your life, own your livelihood, they own your careers. And there is no risk mitigation for the service member in that regard, none. Mm-hmm. You can cite all the laws you want, but in practice, it is 100% personal risk on that person, 0% chance of reward. And that can and needs to change.
So disheartening, right? I'm the kind of person that you and I talked about this ahead of time, but I'm the kind of person that would storm the castle if I could, right? And that's not always the best or most productive way to bring change about. So I kind of have to, like, that's my first, second, and third draft. I have to go to the fourth and fifth draft. It's just usually once I slow down and think about it long enough. To me, it goes back to, maybe for those who are listening, whether there is something that you want to bring up and you want to bring into the light, or maybe you're a leader where you have the opportunity to do what's right in serving people and serving people better, whichever side you're on. To me, I go back to that feeling that I'm also having of, why am I carrying so much anxiety about something that seems okay and so right and not wrong? And I think it is that first step of looking into not just your spirit, but also paying attention to your body. I think our body is carrying a lot of rules and constraints and regulations that we've in beliefs that we've picked up over time in this lifestyle, and our body sometimes reacts before our brain ever does. And I feel like for me this week, the thought has been, I really need to pay attention to what this anxiety is and where it comes from, and then ask myself, where is that coming from? Who's saying that? Am I actually doing anything wrong by saying anything? How do I find the courage to do the right thing? And also communicate through the whole process to educate people. I talk about throughout the book, like, there are opportunities where we can either evolve or we can stay the same. But either way, it's an opportunity to mentor someone through evolution, or it's an opportunity to educate of why we can't. And I think it comes down to communication. So being able to know yourself and communicate what's going on and ask questions and create conversation, like, it makes me want to go to other spouses, especially senior spouses, and go, why are we feeling anxious about just having a normal conversation? Where is that coming from? Where can we trace that back? And is that something we want to keep in the culture? Where does that play out into the future? Does it help us move towards a culture that we want to stay in, and a culture that we would want our children and grandchildren to stay in? And if not, how can we start to change the way we lead, change the way we communicate, change sometimes our expectations? So I think that's the first step that's been on my mind a lot, is just being able to communicate yourself and know what's going on within you, and be able to just start having conversation and dialogue and asking questions.
Yeah, I agree. And unfortunately, or fortunately, whichever way you want to look at it, a lot of my cases, the people I advise, they don't get the justice they probably deserve.
Yeah. Right?
But I close with the silver lining in that twofold. Number one, you as the advisee can pay it forward, right? You can put it into the conversation, just like you said. You can educate others on what you went through and how you went through it, and maybe help prevent the next victim complainant from ever occurring. But the second facet, and maybe the more important one of that silver lining, is that through the process, everything is entered into the conversation, right? It goes from some isolated incident behind an opaque curtain to something out there. And I think there's value in that. And I think the more that it goes into the public ether, the more it's discussed, the more it's seen, the more reason that the military will have reason for some introspection. And it kind of goes back a little bit to this whole recruiting retention issue. The reason there are so many questions from our service age youth is because we've put it out there as that conversation, right? That didn't happen in our generation. And that's a relatively new thing, but although it's disruptive, I believe it's positive.
Yeah.
It's difficult to tell an advisee who was just a victim of a career-ending reprisal, for instance, like, look, the battle is lost. I'm sorry. And unfortunately, most battles are. But the war is yet to be won. And the war is this significant systemic change that you're helping to bring about by bringing this into the limelight, by introducing the conversation, by getting real change.
Yeah, I would agree. And I think that's an incredible silver lining, to be able to sometimes tell people, this is going to be a long road to change, but you're a part of helping to change it. And this new younger generation is not going to shift their perspectives. What they're asking for is important, and it's necessary. And anytime we're looking at changing a pattern in any relationship, whoever is able to hold their ground the longest usually wins in changing the pattern, whether it is holding your ground until the other disruptive entity chooses to stop fighting, or whether you are so convinced that this has to change that you can outlast and force the pattern to change, because if you don't change the pattern, I'm going to abandon the relationship. And I think that's what we're seeing happen.
This is a critical point right here, because for the longest time, and since we've been in operation of the foundation, the number one arsenal that the DOD, the Department of Defense, can draw upon is that they can outspend and outweight anyone. Yeah. Right. Congress, senator, complainant, what have you.
An entire cohort that went to war.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yes, they can win by doing nothing. That's an incredible advantage. And this is why, and I've seen it, and I've seen many clients just capitulate because they're just ground, because the juggernaut just keeps going and it is immovable. But this is why I've become so interested in this recruiting question, because it's not going away.
Yeah.
Generation Z has to be convinced, and they will win by doing nothing. And it is an incredible turning of the tables. It's the first time I can think of, and we could name any kind of systematic epidemic, so to speak, that's occurred to the military that they've just outweighed, whether it be the vaccine debacle or military sexual trauma or whatever pops up and is still hot. They've always been able to quote unquote defeat it by just sitting there. Right. Mm-hmm. And this, for the first time, at least in post World War II era, save for the draft, they are forced to come to the table. And I see that as an opportunity for real change. It's okay. We can introduce things that the DOD would have never been amenable to, save for this recruiting crisis. And that's why I think it's such a positive thing for the country.
Yeah, I am fascinated. I am also fascinated to watch all of this when I'm working with couples who are in a serious, at a major decision point in their relationship, and there is a toxic pattern that's happening, and one person has decided, I want something healthier in this relationship. We walk through, this is how you change a pattern in a relationship. And I always tell them there's three things that can happen. One, you are forced back into the old pattern because it's too hard for you to ask for something different or enforce something to be different. So that's what happens most of the time. We fall back into what's comfortable. And to your point, that's why I think the DOD just waits out people and they just kind of go back to the old pattern. But I said, if you can outlast that, and if you recognize it as the chaos that is happening because you're asking for something to be different. And right now we are in the chaos. We are in the chaos of one entity, Gen Z, is asking for something different. DOD wants to wait them out and see if they'll just fall back into the old pattern. If anybody can last through that chaos and go, you know what, only two other things two other things can happen if I don't fall back into the old pattern. One, you're willing to create a new pattern with me, or the relationship dissolves. Those are the only two things that can happen. And in a relationship, if it's your marriage, if you're listening right now, there's great freedom in knowing those are the only three things that can happen. And most people are so afraid of the relationship disintegrating, they'd rather fall back into an old pattern. But if you know that you know that you know that this needs to be healthier, and you're willing to your point, Ryan, value that more, and you can stand your ground because it is more important to you than whether or not the relationship succeeds, new patterns can be established. And sometimes that new pattern is Gen Z going, I'd rather go work in corporate America. And so I'm fascinated to watch what the reaction is going to be, because I think you're right. I think the tables have turned, and Gen Z, they don't have anything on the table to fight. They're just willing to go somewhere else.
Yeah, they are essentially, in essence, employing the DOD tactic of outweight on the DOD, and they're going to win. Yeah. And we have two converging paths here. We have potential conflict with peer or near peer adversaries in the future, whether you believe that or not, we still need a viable military regardless. And we have a generation that doesn't want to serve. And those are two foregone conclusions, that those courses won't be altered. So the thing that must happen is that the department must change its ways, period.
I could go on forever with you, Ryan. Phenomenal conversation. If I sound excited, I'm just really excited because it's so remarkable of something to watch. Like, I want to get my popcorn out and just see what happens. And I'm so proud. It sounds terrible because people are hurting, you know, but when it comes to how do you change a system? I think that's really what we're talking about is, oftentimes you may not be in the cohort or the generation that sees the system change, and that's really hard. And we sometimes have to zoom out. maybe I'm speaking to maybe some of the victims that you've worked with when I say sometimes we have to zoom out and see that we were part of a bigger war. We were part of a bigger thing that needed to happen over time. When I think about women's rights, civil rights, so many of these battles have taken a really long time to talk through and to position yourself. To use Peter Docker from Leading from the Jump Seat, he talks about the difference between values and a stand. A stand is something that you're not willing to budge on at all, and it's still ranked in your values. And when there's something that's this strong, it's willing to take a stand over, even if it means that you're in a longer war. And so, Ryan, I'm just grateful for everything that you're doing, that you found your second service as a way to invest and still take care of people and still participate in the institution in a different way that gives you a little bit more control, that aligns with your values, I think, that really takes care of people in a way that you wish somebody would have probably done for you. And I think that that is not only remarkable, but it is the sign of a good leader, a great leader. And I'm just so grateful that you do it. And I'm so grateful that you wrote the essay that you did that allowed me to find you and go, yes, someone else is saying hard things. It's really hard to find the courage to say things that are difficult that could bring negative attention. And you got a few of those comments, but there's also people hopefully that are on the sidelines that come out and go, you're right.
Yeah. And like you said, it's a stand, right? This is something you and I vehemently believe in. It may come across sometimes as crass, cynical, storm in the castle, scorched earth, but we do it for one reason. And that is because we believe in our country. We believe in our ideals. And we believe that both need to be protected with a strong, viable, healthy military. Right? Yeah. That is the end state of all this. And sometimes that gets lost in the noise and the rhetoric. But at the end of the day, you and I are clearly very passionate about achieving that one thing. And I know we're going to be successful.
It seemed to be easy for you, but there are some things I wish you knew. I dreamed of a house on a hill with a cat or two. I dreamed every night of a path that leads back to you. And let my anger be transformed before I'm left out in the cold. There's parts of you that I still miss.
We all know the story of David victoriously taking down the giant Goliath with simply a sling and a stone. But this is the privilege of hindsight. In reality, the people around David, including his family, thought he was mad and underestimated his passion to end the harassment of the giant. Despite the king offering him armor, he refused. He was not yet the warrior he would one day become. So he faced Goliath with the confidence of who he knew he was and in alignment with what he believed. David would later not only become king, but lead a group called the Mighty Men, the special forces of that time. It may take a madman to face a giant, but it is often those we think mad that become giants we want to follow.
And let my anger be transformed. For I'm left out in the cold. I've been trying to forgive the things I can't tell my therapist. You take and never give. I let my anger become bitterness. I dreamed of a house on a hill with a cattle.
The Military Culture Shift podcast is sponsored by New Res Home Mortgages and written and produced by me, author, speaker, and military clinical consultant, Corie Weathers. It is a supplemental leadership podcast for the book Military Culture Shift, The Impact of War, Money, and Generational Perspective on Morale, Retention, and Leadership. Copies of the book can be purchased on Amazon, militaryfamilybooks.com, and your other favorite retailers. Our closing song is Bitterness, written by producer, songwriter, and military teen Bailey Hamrick. More information, including graphs, data, and other resources mentioned in the book, can be found on my website, CorieWeathers.com.